All right, everyone. It is 6 p.m., so we are going to go ahead and get started for this evening. I just want to say, first of all, thank you all for joining us over the past 6 weeks for this class. We were very excited to be able to continue it, even with the shutdown of everything, and you know, we're happy that so many people were able to join us online. When we do finally open theater back up and produce our production of Hamlet, hopefully everyone will be able to come see it with some insight into the play and even into our specific production. Our last class is going to be helmed by Emily Rockefeller. And Emily is a friend to CSC. She's on our board, and she's actually part of the education committee on the board. So she and I, as well as Ron and some other folks in that committee, work together to create all of the educational programming that we have here. Emily is currently in her 14th year as a teacher at McDonough High School, and before that she was at Garrison Forest. And in that time she has worked as a AP English teacher, teaching, amongst other things, this play to students. And so she's going to bring some insight. You know, I am happy to have Emily. For anyone that knows me, you know that I hate to listen to a bunch of men talk 24/7. So I'm glad that we were able to get some female representation in our panel of teachers. And I'm sure that she's going to bring some new interesting ideas. And Emily, I'm going to throw the ball to you.
Okay, thank you very much. It's really nice to be here. Thank you for asking me to do it. I got very excited. I haven't taught Hamlet for a little bit, but it was really fun to go back to my notes and sort of review the trajectory of the way that I had taught it in the past. I wanted to start by, thanking you for having me and just saying that I am not by any means an expert. I don't have anything like the expertise of some of the other folks who have presented. I'm just somebody who's thought a lot about the play, and I certainly know that I'm not the only teacher here. So please, I want lots of other folks to join in, and definitely do not see me as the sage on the stage, because I am very far from being that. To the degree that I have any expertise about Hamlet, I suppose I am used to conducting discussions about it with high school students. So I do have a few ways that, at least in my mind, make it a little bit more relevant. I'm quite used to dealing with Hamlet skeptics. I am a bit of a Hamlet skeptic. I don't love Hamlet. He's not my favorite Shakespearean character. I can appreciate him, and I've appreciated him more and more as I've read the play more and more, but I definitely am not a huge fan. So I think that's actually a helpful perspective. I really enjoyed some of the other presenters who also were wanting to talk about Hamlet in some complex and not always praiseful ways, laudatory ways. So that's definitely one part of my perspective. And as I said, I'm used to making the play a little bit more approachable and inviting people to have a conversation about it. So that's what I hope to do today. I do have some slides, and I definitely am gonna do some talking, but I also have built in places to pause. And I'm really hoping to get a conversation going during those pauses. I know that you guys have been conversing about the play already. I did go back and listen to the classes. So I have heard everything. I did not finish out the very last one, but I did listen to sessions 1 through 4. Yeah, sessions 1 through 4. I didn't quite finish 5, but I did listen to the sessions 1 through 4 and really enjoyed those. So I do know that you're willing to talk and willing to read speeches and all that good stuff. So that's what I'm hoping for. Any questions, comments, anything before I launch in to what I have prepared? Okay. I'm not a huge fan of, I've been teaching on Zoom. I've been teaching my McDonough classes on Zoom. So I'm fairly conversant with how it works. I'm not a huge fan of the raise hand function. I will call on you if I see that you've raised your hand, but sometimes I'll be sharing my screen and then I don't see the raised hand. So my preference, my strong preference would be that you simply unmute yourself and talk. If people happen to talk over one another, or if two people volunteer to read a scene simultaneously, you know, I think we can negotiate that and figure that out. So I would rather just have you unmute yourself and say something. I also do like the chat function. It can be a little tricky sometimes to call it up and to read what the chats say, but that is another thing that you can use, obviously, if you just want to type your comment. Okay, so I'm going to start off by presenting a beginning. I'm going to present a beginning, and then I'm going to ask for some comments on what I have mentioned. So this is a starting point for me. I'm going to share my screen. This is a starting point for me. Let's see. I'm not quite sure what screen's going to come up first. Oh, it's going to be that. Yeah, that's not what I wanted to show you. Give me 1 second, I'll click over to the right one. Okay, here we go. A starting point for me in Hamlet is a pattern of words that the more I read the play started to really jump out at me, to the point that it became one of those earworms that I couldn't stop hearing. I just kept hearing over and over again the repeated use of this pair of words, which are natural and unnatural. And I've never gone to one of those word count things. I know there are websites you can go to and you can scan Shakespeare texts and do counts of particular words. And I've never done that. But I do know that this word natural comes up so many times in Hamlet. And I got to be very interested in that because I think we today in 2020 have a default assumption that natural is a good thing. Right? Like natural foods, natural scenes, nature, it's good. But I don't think that was the default assumption in 1600. And so I started to get very interested in what is happening with this pattern of things being natural versus things being unnatural. And I think it takes us to a number of different places in the play. And that's kind of my starting point. That's my in for today. So, I'm not sure natural is good. So the first thing I want to do is trace the different ways that this word natural gets used in Act One. It's got at least 3 definitions that I could see. And I want to just start there and then get your comments on that and then see where this pattern of natural and unnatural takes us. All right, so definition number one, and I tried to put these in order from most straightforward to slightly less straightforward. Definition number one of natural seems to be some kind of passionate emotion, you know, ungoverned emotion. And the first place this comes up, I'm actually going to move this. Okay. Hang on 1 second. I can see my links. There we go. The first place this comes up is when Claudius is referring to the death of his brother. This is Claudius' very first speech in the play. And he says at one point in the speech, and we can read the whole thing, but he says at one point in the speech that his discretion has fought with his nature so that he with wisest sorrow thinks on his brother. And then he goes on to give kind of a series of oxymorons about dirge in marriage and mirth in funeral and all these different oxymorons. But it seems when he says this, that discretion fighting with nature is that his natural response to his brother's death would be to be really, really sad, but he's using his discretion to battle that and to put that down. The ghost seems to use the word in the same way when he says to Hamlet, if thou hast nature in thee, bear it not. If you have any kind of passionate emotion about my murder, bear it not, kill your uncle, you know, do this deed that I'm telling you to do. Those two places of the word nature seem similar to me, and it seems like the first definition. So I'm gonna stop sharing for just a second and see if you have thought about that. Does anybody want to pause there with a question or a comment just about that first definition?
I thought that second definition of the second use of nature is really the opposite of what you said. I think if you have human nature in you, bear not the horror that I'm going to tell you about. So I think that it's used that way rather than the way that you saw it in the first way, in Claudius's speech.
So that's really interesting. So I think that's kind of the question I'm raising, is what exactly is human nature? Is it human nature to be rational and to use our discretion and to govern our emotions? Or is it human nature to be passionate and wildly emotional? Do you see what I'm saying? Like, I'm not quite sure which one. And I think actually in this first act, it's pretty slippery which definition is meant. But yeah, I mean, it cuts both ways.
So is this kind of the difference between bestial, I think would be maybe the other aspect, bestial nature versus human, and the difference between human and animal?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Irrational or irrational.
Yeah, it would make sense that Claudius, who's bestial in himself and called that in the play, would think of nature as bestial, where the ghost, who's the Hamlet senior and thought of as compassionate and a good king, would see nature as a good thing. So they're both using it from their own points of view. And
yeah.
It would make sense that, you know, nature in Claudius's case is bestial nature, but nature in Hamlet Sr.'s case is a compassionate human nature.
Yeah, and I think you're anticipating my next point, which is that nature can also simply mean personality. Mm-hmm. But I also would pause for a second, because one of my questions about the play is whether Hamlet Sr. was really a good king. And I know you have talked about this already with, you know, sort of his relationship with younger Hamlet and whether that might have been a little problematic in terms of expectations. You know, maybe he wanted a son who was a warrior and that kind of thing. And I have some doubts about the character of Hamlet Sr., but that's a little bit further along. Any other thoughts or comments about this nature so far? Okay. Thank you for joining in right away. I'm gonna go back to sharing my screen. And, okay, great. Okay, so first, maybe it means passionate, ungoverned emotion. And then, as I said, Howard, you anticipated this. Maybe it means, skipped one. Yeah, there it is. Okay. Maybe it means personality, right? Like you said, they each seem to be using it with reference to their own personality. So maybe nature means personality. And here, picking up a little bit later with Claudius's speech, he after sending Laertes off, he turns to Hamlet and he says that it's sweet and commendable in your nature, Hamlet, to give these morning duties to your father. But you must know your father lost a father, that father lost his, and the survivor bound, and so on and so forth. And then he goes on, he says a few other things about grief, that it's unmanly. And then here it gets kind of interesting at the bottom. He says that this unmanly grief is a fault to heaven, a fault against the dead, a fault to nature, to reason most absurd. So there he seems to be placing nature and reason opposite one another. So we may come back to that speech, but let me just keep going with this idea of nature being personality and personality flaws. So I know you already talked about this speech a little bit. This is Hamlet talking about the Danes carousing and getting drunk. And he finds their behavior, he condemns it. And he talks about them having a vicious mole of nature in them, that breaks down the pales and forts of their reason. So again, we've got that opposition between nature and reason. And they have a habit that o'erleavens their manners, kind of throws their manners over. And the stamp of that defect, being nature's livery or fortune's star, kind of corrupts their whole self. So here, nature is taking on a little bit of a negative tone where it produces vicious faults in people. Finally, and this is included more here for completion than anything else, but the ghost also seems to be talking about personality when he talks about Claudius's natural gifts not being, not matching his own. And again, there it's more positive, but he does seem to be talking about personality. So I'm gonna stop sharing and pause again on that and see if we have some further thoughts or further reactions. Does this seem to you like a different definition, or does it seem like the same definition? What are we looking at here?
My thought was that it's somewhat similar, but more in terms of like what is common, what is in the common course. So when he talks about it's a fault to nature, what's in your nature, what is common, what is, you know, what, you know, it's being commendable in your nature, in who you are, maybe, but, you know, it's just what is natural to you, what is usual to you, and then is a fault to nature, fault to, you know, what is in the common course of events, because it's in the common course of events, because he's talking about your father lost a father, so to bemoan this is to bemoan what is just usual in the world.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. I always assumed that the vicious mole speech was about nature versus nurture, genes versus upbringing. That's the way I read it. I don't know if that's correct or not.
I think it is. I think, and that's certain. I mean, nature and native and natal, right? They all have the same root. So I do think that there's something about nature that has to do with something you're born with, the personality traits that you're born with. Versus the ones that are learned later. And it is interesting too, because not only does nature and natural come up a lot in the play, but native does as well. The native hue of resolution is sicklied or with the pale cast of thought. And there again, it's like native resolution, but pale cast of thought. There's a little bit of rationality versus irrationality there as well. So I think you're right about it having something to do with nature versus nurture and birth.
Okay. Hi. This is Cynthia.
Hi, Cynthia.
So as we're talking about all this natural and nature and who you are, I know I'm leaping way ahead, but this is something that's blocking my mind. When Hamlet compares himself to an actor, and what is Hecuba? And so I'm getting stuck right there that, you know, as we're talking about natural and nature, he's comparing himself to an actor who is anything but true and natural. So right now that's where my thoughts are, and everything else is just kind of like paling in comparison. So I just wanted to throw that out there of natural and nature, and he's comparing himself to an actor. I'm not feeling that one.
I'm waiting to see if somebody else is going to jump in. No, I don't think you're jumping way ahead or leaping, making an unwarranted leap in any way at all. That's one of the places I think this takes us. I mean, I think this pattern of talking about what's natural and what's not natural is not just me, you know, picking out some words that happen to come up a bunch of times in the play. I mean, the play is really interested. Hamlet himself is really interested in artifice and deception, and how is that constructed, and how is that built, and when is that a good thing, and when is that a bad thing, right? I mean, Claudius, and we'll go back to the oxymorons and to Hamlet's most characteristic figure of speech, which is the pun, right? But Claudius has a way of using language to create a reality where, you know, I always think of an oxymoron as sort of a force fit, you know? It's like, I'm gonna make it be what I want. And that's Claudius's way of creating reality. Like, I married this woman and now I'm the king, and this, you know, this is what it's gonna be. And that's indicative of his personality, right? And Hamlet has a different way of using language. And then the players have their own, obviously, way of using language, which is to a certain degree an artifice, but then that becomes Hamlet's tool for investigating the truth. So no, I mean, yeah, like that's one of the reasons why that whole pattern and development is one of the reasons why I think thinking about natural versus unnatural is really worth doing. Does that make sense?
I have a question. There's a lot of religiosity in this play. Like Hamlet not killing the king while he's praying because then he'll go straight to heaven. And I'm just wondering about nature versus religion.
Right. That's a place where I've thought about it a little bit less. I do remember that in that speech where Claudius is praying, he talks about his fault being seen in its true nature in heaven, that on earth he can disguise it, but in heaven it will be seen in its true nature. But that again is a little bit of a slippery place for me, because one of the ways I understand nature versus things that are unnatural is like unnatural is sort of human institutions and human belief systems, and civilization is to a certain degree unnatural, right? It's opposed to things that grow and move across the sky, which I'm about to get to. But so I don't know where religion fits. And I'm not sure I think Hamlet has some questions about where religion fits. Is morality natural, or is morality rational and therefore kind of unnatural? I don't know. It goes back to what Howard was asking about human nature. Is human nature rational, or is human nature irrational? Because nature in this play can kind of mean both a little bit. I don't have tons of answers, but these are the questions I think that come up with this pattern, and this is sort of why I think it's really worth investigating, if that makes sense. I'm gonna go back to the slideshow and look at just the third, what I think of as the third definition of nature, just in act one. But before I do that, are there any more comments?
Well, I thought related to, I think it was Cynthia's point about the play acting, very early on, one of Hamlet's very first statements is that they say that he seems to be taking his father's death poorly, and his response is, it is, mm-hmm. which is obviously right into Cynthia's point about the play acting versus not play acting, and it also sort of fits into the idea of nature or artifice. So acting. I do think that the two kind of, they're explorations of the same idea.
Yeah. Exactly. That speech is about the trappings and the suits of woe, right? Which he says, yeah, I'm wearing those. I'm wearing that costume. And it is a very theatrical term. And he's making kind of a theatrical statement. He's kind of telling his mom, yeah, I could just act sad. You'd probably buy it. But I'm not just acting sad. I am, in fact, actually sad. So I do think that speech is directly connected to his interest in play acting and deceit, and again, how is that built? How is that constructed? What are the words that are used to make it? Does that make sense? Okay, I'm gonna go, like I said, I'm gonna share my screen and go to this third definition. So this third definition is, I think, kind of, if I were just to say the word nature in 2020 out of context, I think this might be what we would think of. This is sort of the natural world, right? And I wanted to not use the word nature in my definition, which is why I headlined it sky and earth phenomena, and also bodies, right? Like your physical body is a natural thing in this play. And the couple of quotations I have about this are, Hamlet talking about the world feeling to him like an unweeded garden. And he says, fie on it, ah, fie, 'tis an unweeded garden that grows to seed. It's one of my favorite lines for some reason. I just like the sound of it. Things rank and gross in nature possess it merely. And I think somebody who is a better Elizabethan wordsmith can correct me, but I'm pretty sure merely here means fully, like entirely, which is not really what it means for us. I think this was referred to in a previous session too, is that rank is another one of Hamlet's favorite words. Rank comes up a lot and never in a good way. Rank seems to mean rotten and damp and moist. It's yucky. So here it's paired with gross. Things rank and gross in nature possess it merely. And this goes back to one of my first things, which is nowadays we think of nature as lovely and organic and good. But I don't think the Elizabethans necessarily saw it that way. I think that to a certain degree for them, nature was a little bit scary and a little bit ungovernable and hard to deal with, like an unweeded garden, right? Like a garden that's growing out of control. Laertes' speech, and this might be one where I want to click over and look at more of it. So this is Laertes advising Ophelia that she should not take Hamlet's love seriously, that his love is in the youth of primy, I think it's primy, primy nature. And then at the end of that speech, at the end of that warning speech, he talks about nature crescent. And he seems to be talking about the body there. Nature crescent does not grow alone in thews and bulk. And I think thews, if I'm not mistaken, is like muscle tissue, right? So he's kind of saying your body growing, your physical body, its nature is not to only grow in physical bulk, but as this temple, and the temple is the body, it's the temple for the soul, right? As this temple waxes, the inward service of the mind also grows wide withal. And I'm going to click over actually, yeah, I think I will do that. I'm going to click over and look at that whole speech because it ends in a really interesting way and I want to come back to it. And instead of me reading, maybe if somebody could chime in, and read that whole speech. Hang on one sec. Oops. I'm gonna go back. Sorry, I'm jumping ahead. Hang on. Let me go back to where it was. That's the one. So here's the speech, this part, the chariest maid. Could I get somebody to read from the chariest maid through the end of Laertes' speech? And again, I can't see your hands, so if somebody would just jump in, I would love that.
The chariest maid is prodigal enough if she unmask her beauty to the moon. Virtue itself scapes not calumnious strokes. The canker galls the infants of the spring too oft before their buttons be disclosed, and in the morn and liquid dew of youth, contagious blastments are more imminent. Be wary then, best safety lies in fear. Youth to itself rebels, though none else near.
Okay, thank you very much. That was great. I'm going to stop sharing again for just a sec and get your thoughts about that speech. It's another one, rank and gross, I think is a very meaty phrase. I also like contagious blastments. So what are some thoughts about that or questions about that part of Laertes' speech to Ophelia? Should I put it back up? I shall. There you go. The chariest maid is prodigal enough. Do we know what infants of the spring are? I don't know if anybody's looking at a text with a note.
Are those like buds or seeds?
Yeah, I think that's right. I think the notes that I've usually seen say that an infant of the spring is a bud, like a flower bud. So what Laertes seems to be saying is that flower buds can be rotten on the inside before they even open, which is a little terrifying and a little, again, like a very negative view of nature. The canker galls the infants of the spring too oft before their buttons be disclosed. And in the morn and liquid dew of youth, when you think you're young and fresh, that's when contagious blastments maybe have already gotten you, right? Maybe you're already rotten and you just don't even know it. Which again, like not a real happy, positive, organic view of nature, the way we kind of think of it now. And this is actually the speech that I'm gonna wanna come back to at the end. Oops, I just stopped sharing. That's not actually what I wanted to do. So let me go back to that for just a sec. And go back to away from the text and back to the slides. Okay. All right. So that's nature as phenomena of the sky and earth and bodies. Your physical body is nature. And this is also, again, in the spirit of completion, this is also what the ghost seems to be talking about when he's talking about being poisoned. And he says that the poison, which, by the way, was also a natural substance, right? It was coming from a plant. But it coursed through the natural gates and alleys of the body. And with a sudden vigor, it created clots or curds, which, maybe this is not an appropriate thing to say, but it sounds frighteningly like coronavirus, which you're hearing in the news recently makes clots in people. So it's a little bit, I was a little bit struck when I read this this time around. The last one I cheated a little bit. This speech of Horatio doesn't actually use the word nature, but he is talking about natural phenomena. He's talking about eclipses and how eclipses are portentous, ominous signs of something terribly wrong in the human order. So I think that's kind of relevant here. He talks about this unexplained phenomena of the dead rising from their graves in ancient Rome. And then he says, disasters in the sun and the moist star, which is the moon, was sick almost to doomsday with eclipse. So this phenomena, this natural phenomena of an eclipse is like a disease and a terrible ominous sign. All right, so we've already talked about some of these, but the questions I have for you about these quotations are these definitions of nature, where do they seem to overlap and where do they seem at odds with one another? And then what do you make of the remaining quotations that I didn't mention, which the most prominent one is that the ghost tells Hamlet, and he uses the word twice, right? He's like really emphatic about it. Revenge my most foul and unnatural murder. If you bear your father love, revenge his foul and most unnatural murder. Murder most foul is in the best it is, but this most foul, strange, and unnatural. There's a couple other quotes there. He refers also to talking about being in purgatory. He talks about the foul crimes that were done in his days of nature. And Hamlet also refers to the ghost as making him and the others who see it fools of nature. And we can go to those speeches if you want to, but what are some, and I'll leave the questions up there, but what are some reactions to the different definitions and to the idea that the murder is unnatural?
I'll just jump in and quickly and say they're all, other than one of them, they're all family members. I don't know what that means, but they're either brothers or uncles or sons. I don't know what that means. And I don't know if it continues further into the play.
When you say they, you mean who, victims of murder or?
Hamlet, his father, and his uncle.
Right, okay, yeah, yeah. No, so I think that fact is something there, right? Like, what makes the murder unnatural? Is it unnatural in its coldness, right? Like, you're not killing somebody that you don't know. You're not killing a stranger, killing a family member. And before, one of the definitions of natural was emotion and passion. So maybe what's unnatural here is that Claudius has been so cold and so emotionless as to kill a brother.
Well, I'd like to suggest that it's a little, that we're overthinking it a bit here, because he had just said that in Act One, something about, you know, his father had died and his father had died. And he was talking about how death is the natural progression. So murder is an unnatural progression.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Against the natural order.
Right.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Yeah, no, that makes total sense too. That makes total sense too. And again, like, I think that slipperiness of the word, or those couple of different definitions of the word are really interesting.
Well, and the murder, it's not just any murder, it's fratricide in particular. I think that's what makes it most unnatural, is that it's killing a family member.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
It's also regicide. right? So that's as unnatural in monarchy structures as you can get.
But what's natural about a monarchy structure? I mean, that, you know, like that's a human institution. I don't.
It's passed on genetically. I would say
true.
It's,
yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's natural because it's passed on genetically that way.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Well, and I would think that, in the sense of how, you know, Elizabethans would have looked at it in their mind, the monarch, the king or queen, was placed in their position of power by God, which is nothing so much as nature itself made mighty. So striking at the king is striking at God, and therefore striking at nature, so therefore the most unnatural, along mm-hmm. with killing of a family member, so doubly mm-hmm. unnatural.
Because all those systems are part of the natural order, the natural way of the world. Yeah, I think that's, there's a lot there, but I also do wonder, I mean, I think earlier there was some discussion of the actual structure of Danish politics, right? And the fact that there was a parliament, right? That it's called the Thing, I think. So I kind of wonder a little bit exactly how automatic and quote unquote natural some of these things were. I could be wrong about this as well, but I feel like Queen Elizabeth was sometimes thought of as an unnatural woman because she was so masculine and so manly. So I do think that there's some questions about what's ordained and what's natural that are floating in the time. Like I'm not sure that the automaticness of the monarchy was as unquestioned maybe as I just don't know.
In Elizabethan, well, in Tudor times altogether, it was actually treason to question that the monarch was ordained by God and therefore, you know, had the right to be on the throne. Anybody who tried to take the throne was committing treason and a sin.
Mm. Yeah.
If I can say something,
please.
This makes me think a little bit about, you know, you hear the phrase that who's the good guy or who's the bad guy depends on who's writing the story, and I think. Looking at this Danish rule and kind of how power transferred from leader to leader, there may have been some unnatural, just going off of that term, elements in how Claudius got to the throne. When we look at Fortinbras, who is striking out against the Danish kingdom, I think for him, this Danish ruler is an unnatural ruler, and their sort of a usurpation of, you know, of that area of land at the time was unnatural to Fortinbras and that clan, whereas to King Hamlet and Claudius and Hamlet to this clan of people, it seemed like they deserved the land or that they were the rightful heirs to it. So, you know, it kind of makes me think that maybe the idea of what's natural, what's unnatural depends on who the storyteller is. Does that make any sense?
Yeah, it does. And you know, if it has positive connotations, which again, I'm not sure it always does, but if it has positive connotations, then describing something as natural is a way of seizing control of it, right? And saying like, well, this happened because it was natural. And that makes it good and that makes it okay. But I think it's, I want to ask some questions about that. And a couple of people have referred to Claudius saying, you know, that pointing out that death of fathers is the natural order. I have always found that speech really, really problematic. Let me see if I can go back to it. It's actually not quoted. Oh yeah, no, here it is, this part. But you must know your father lost a father, that father lost his, and the survivor bound in filial obligation for some term to due obsequious sorrow. That speech has always felt, for lack of a better word, unnaturally cold and rational to me. I think it's a little bit overcompensating, right? Yes, he's saying it's the natural course of things for fathers to die, but he's saying that with a lack of emotion and a lack of sympathy that feels really, you know, to go back to the ghost's word about unnatural possibly meaning cold and how could you kill your brother, he's saying that this is the natural order with an unnatural lack of sympathy, lack of emotion. To me, I find that phrasing, you must know your father lost a father, that father lost his, I find that very offhand and weirdly cold. So that's why I think, it's the pattern is just interesting, and the slipperiness of how the terms are used is interesting. Okay, back at these questions. Is this where we were? I think it is. Any other comments? The next slide picks up on what Cynthia was saying about the different ways that Hamlet seems concerned with acting and with how language builds some natural and unnatural patterns, which is really where we are, right? With this idea of using the word to your advantage. I think somebody was gonna say something. No, I imagined it. Okay. All right, so I'm gonna click to the next one and then, okay, so we, what I just laid out from Act One was repeated uses of the word natural, ending with unnatural. So then I'm kind of wondering, you know, from there, wondering what else is unnatural? And this is where we start talking about putting on behaviors and putting on an antic disposition, right? There's a lot of interest in the play, as Cynthia has already mentioned, there's a lot of interest in the play in how does external appearance reflect or not reflect what's happening on the inside. We already mentioned the trappings and suits of woe speech. There's the speech about Hamlet, and I'm gonna go to this one actually. Hamlet, as soon as he hears from the ghost about the murder, which is here, he says, remember thee, yea, from the table of my memory, I'll wipe away all trivial fond records, all saws of books, all forms, all pressures past. So he's gonna throw away all his rational tools of learning, right? He's gonna throw all that away. He's gonna throw away his books. He's gonna throw away Proverbs. He's gonna throw away everything he's learned at Wittenberg. And the ghost's commandment all alone shall live within the book and volume of my brain, unmixed with baser matter. And then two lines later, he says, my table's meat it is, I set it down. So he's just thrown away all his books, and then he calls for another book to write it down. Which, when I'm thinking about rationality, you know, if part of what's happening with natural and unnatural is rational and irrational, this strikes me as a really interesting speech, really characteristic of Hamlet, that his first instinct is to be like, oh, I'm so passionately worked up about this, I'm gonna throw away all my learning and just pursue this. Wait a second, I gotta write it down. It tells me about Hamlet that, you know, going back to Howard's point about is it human nature to be emotional or is it human nature to be rational? And it varying for different people, you know, like different people use the word to depending on their own personality. Hamlet seems to be automatically, naturally, a very rational guy. It's really hard for him to get worked up into an emotional state. At least it's hard for him to get worked up into an emotional state about some things. I think he gets really worked up about other things, but that's sort of where the conversation happens. So that's, again, the word's not used there, but that's kind of an interesting one that has to do with rationality versus irrationality. Him putting an antic disposition on has to do with using language, using particular words to characterize himself as mad when he may not be. The speech about the players, you know, how could this player king, and I know you've talked about this one before, how could the player king work himself up to such a state of emotion when he doesn't even have the cause to act that I do? And Hamlet says, I'm really going to do it this time. And then as somebody pointed out in a previous discussion, the end of that is, I'm going to act. No, I'm going to put on a play, which feels to a lot of people who read it and who see it, it feels a little bit anticlimactic. And again, kind of like passionate emotion. I'm gonna really use my emotional drive to get this murder done. And then kind of backing off to a more rational way of being. Another one is when he points out to Ophelia that women in general are offensive to him. He's very angry and worked up at that part. Because they jig and amble and they lisp and they seem to put on false faces and take on false behaviors for their own gain or for something else. So I'm gonna stop sharing and get your comments about some of those speeches and that kind of theme in the play.
Isn't he angry with Ophelia because he realizes that they're eavesdropping on him, they're spying on him. Mm-hmm. The penny drops, right? This is all a charade. That's why it blows up. That's the way I interpret it. Yeah.
If he realizes at that point that they're being spied on, yes, but not all productions do that, right? Like, he's also angry because she's just given him back.
Well, there's no doubt that they're standing behind the arras, right? And he suddenly changes halfway through. And
right, he stops in the middle and says, "Where's your father?"
Yeah, right.
It's often the point where it's realized, where somebody says,
like, you're cheating, you're deceiving me. So that's why, yeah. I get worked up. I don't know. That's what I thought.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hi, this is Cynthia again. Mm-hmm. What I'm seeing is he's really trying to figure out what's really important. And when he throws away all of his other books and learning, it's, yeah, I've gone to Wittenberg and I've learned all this stuff and it really doesn't have anything to do with, so I'm cleaning the slate and I'm gonna write down what is truly important. Mm-hmm. And you know, with what we're going through right now, it's like, you know, everything that we thought was important is now taken away. So we have to focus on what really is true, what really is important. And I'm thinking that's what Hamlet is doing, throwing away the schoolwork, the other things that people have told him is important, and he's trying to figure that out for himself.
Yeah, and the thing that he has to write down is that in Denmark, one may smile and be a villain, right? Like, that's how that speech ends. That's what he wants to write down. So what he's writing down is specifically something about deception and people being able to present a face that doesn't reflect the reality. People being able to use tools, sort of to rationally use tools, clothing, expressions, whatever, to create a deception. Other comments? There. Okay. So I want to go back for a second to these very characteristic figures of speech that the two characters, Claudius and Hamlet, have. So it seems to me that you've got this idea emerging about words, language, and other things, you know, costumes, trappings and suits of woe, smiles. There's all these things that can be deceitful, but you also have at the same time Hamlet's decision to create something out of language, to create a play that's going to expose the truth and recreate, reestablish order. At least that's his hope, right? And you have talked in previous sessions, I know, about how that doesn't really happen, and he doesn't seem to have a further plan. But it's his hope that the using the play, this constructed bit of language, this constructed bit of performance, will cause truth to be known. Whereas before, people have used language to deceive, right? Like that's kind of the two-sidedness of words and language. They can be used to deceive, they can be used to establish order and or establish the truth. And I think that given that, the characteristic figures of speech that Claudius and Hamlet use in Act One, which are Claudius using oxymorons versus Hamlet using puns, are really interesting, right? Because Claudius seems to take words and just force them to fit together in a way that doesn't immediately make sense, but he's the king, and so by virtue of his power, it is what it's going to be, right? That sense of like brute authority as having the ability to create a reality. And again, that kind of over-rationality of, you know, discretion overcomes emotion, and, you know, your father died, it's just logical, don't worry about it, or over it. Hamlet's characteristic figure of speech, his first couple of speeches, a little more than kin and less than kind and too much in the sun, he is really interested in the way words can slip. And meaning, different meanings can slip through. When you put words together in unexpected ways, they can mean one thing, but they can also mean another thing, right? So you've got one character who forces things to mean a certain thing, which, look at it, it's like, how does it mean that? And then you've got another character who puts words together in a certain way that shows that meaning slips through in a way that's unexpected. I don't have like a conclusion there. I do think that it goes to the idea, again, which I know you've talked about before, of Hamlet and Claudius having a certain amount in common, right? They are both very good with words. They are both very capable of using words to create reality and using words to manipulate people. Claudius has that scene where he manipulates Laertes into calming down and doing what he needs him to do. So they're both really good at that, but they do use words in two slightly different ways. And I think that the reason I've kind of put all these things together is I do think there's a way in which, at least in the early part of the play, we really need to think about how words can hide a reality. The second bullet point about pulling a kind of barrage of words to disguise what might be more of a conciliary role, I added that after hearing Brendan talk about his particular take on Polonius. Horatio's speech about the history of what happened in Denmark before the death of old Hamlet, I think is really, really interesting and is often overlooked. And this is the moiety competent speech. I don't think that you've talked about this at all. I'm going to click over to it. I think this is a really interesting one. And this is where I wanted to get a little bit back to the character of old Hamlet and what kind of king he really was. He's warlike. We know that he was a warrior, and we know he's in purgatory for sins. So this part, okay, so this is Marcellus asking, why are we making canon at all hours of the day? And Horatio says this, and when I teach this speech, I like to, I will ask for more readers, but this one I'm going to read because I think it's pretty unfamiliar. It goes under the radar. I think people don't pay attention to this speech very much. But I think it tells us something pretty interesting about old Hamlet. And I like to read it really, really quickly because I think what it has is a very legalistic quality. And again, with the idea of rational speech and sometimes overly rational speech hiding a reality that's a little darker, I'm going to try to read it quickly, like almost like a legal disclaimer kind of a reading. But if you can try to see or, you know, figure out what's being described here, I think it gives us some insight into old Hamlet. All right. So why are we preparing for war? Our last king, whose image even but now appeared to us, was, as you know, by Fortinbras of Norway, thereto pricked on by a most emulate pride, dared to the combat, in which our valiant Hamlet, for so this side of our known world esteemed him, did slay this Fortinbras, who, by a sealed compact well ratified by law and heraldry, did forfeit with his life all those his lands which he stood seized of to the conqueror. Against the which, a moiety competent was gaged by our king, which had returned to the inheritance of Fortinbras had he been vanquisher, as by the same covenant and carriage of the article designed, his fell to Hamlet. Now, sir, young Fortinbras of unimproved metal, hot and full, hath in the skirts of Norway here and there, sharked up a list of lawless resolutes and so forth and so forth. That actually is less important. So this bit about what happened between old Hamlet and old Fortinbras, what is Horatio telling us here?
That old Hamlet basically dared Fortinbras to fight him and said, if I win, I get these of your lands, and if you win, you'll get some of my lands.
Yep, exactly. They bet a bunch of land against each other, and it was a bit of a game, right? We're gonna duel, we're gonna fight. And if I win, you get this much land. And if you know, the two parcels of land were set against each other. Does this seem like good governance to you? I see you shaking your head now. Yeah, it doesn't strike me as an especially good way to run your kingdom. It strikes me as a little rash, a little impulsive, a little irrational. A little overly violent, overly given to war. And we know that Hamlet later in the play, young Hamlet later in the play sees the soldiers preparing for the further battle, right? Like young Fortinbras is like, no, that's not gonna stand. I'm gonna get some people together and go get those lands back, right? And we know that Hamlet sees the preparation for that battle. And there's some discussion, there's some speech about the lives of the men whose lives are at stake, right? Like 10,000 or 20,000 preparing to go to war over this, which the origin of it was a bet between two old kings. So I'm throwing that in there because, and I'm gonna stop sharing. Go back to this. I'm throwing that in there because I think it goes to the idea of very rational speech, in this case, what I think of as kind of overly legalistic speech, covering a reality that's a little bit darker, and that's a little bit maybe not quite so rational, that's a little bit violent, a little bit impulsive, a little bit given over to kind of macho feeling. There's a comment.
But couldn't you say that that's how everyone was governing in those days?
I don't know. I don't really know the answer to that. Were they governing by bet? I don't know. I mean, the fact that it's a bet and a duel.
I'm just saying that politics and war were very much the same at that time.
Yeah, yeah.
One thing that's interesting is Claudius, when he is like making peace and having the ambassadors from Norway, is that when they're, you know, going through those negotiations, how they convince Fortinbras to back down is they convince his uncle to, you know, kind of make inroads with him there. And I think it's interesting that we have this contrast where Fortinbras listens to his uncle. And we do see the contrast where Claudius is pursuing diplomacy. So that is a contrast, kind of the war that Hamlet Sr. was waging.
Yeah, and I think, you know, going again to Brendan's discussion of the particular choices of the CSC production, you know, the idea of Claudius as charming and possibly maybe even prepared to be a really good king, you know, maybe there's something about old Hamlet that was a little too given to war. I mean, that's all we know about him, is that he was warlike. He's wearing his battle armor as the ghost. And we know that he did this, you know, he bet some of his lands, and yeah, he happened to win, so that was good. But again, like the decision-making there, I'm not 100% sure of. Whereas maybe Claudius is positioned to be a little bit of a better king.
Well, there's a couple things there. One is that trial by combat was not unknown in the Tudor period, and whoever won was therefore the ordained right, you know, might is right thing. So I see nothing unnatural, to use your term, in two kings having a bet and saying, whichever one of us wins. And it's also a way, like, look at the border conflicts across Europe throughout 1,000 years. You know, how many times did certain areas of Germany and France change hands, or Poland and Lithuania? So this is another way of settling a border dispute without a lot of people getting killed. I don't necessarily think that's a bad thing.
Right. And
the other thing is that I think we should be really careful about taking Shakespeare as literal history. He wasn't a historian, he was a playwright. And so everything he writes about Denmark, we can go back and look at history and say, well, this was or wasn't accurate. But to his audience, this was all the facts that they had to go with. So whatever he wrote, they believed that's what really happened. Mm-hmm. So I wouldn't...
Well, the origin is Saxus Grammaticus, right? Which Belleforest, the French dude, turned into stories in the 16th century. And so the actual tale of Hamlet is like very old. And it was probably standard operating procedure to have fights like this between kings back then, I guess. In the original, that's what it says anyway.
Mm-hmm. I totally hear what you're saying about it possibly being a better way to solve this dispute, right? Like one-on-one instead of pitting the armies against one another. That does make some sense. I guess it's just the kind of, and then we see the same thing with Hamlet, young Hamlet in the play is kind of like the thinking through of the consequence, right? Like, wouldn't it seem to be the case that the opposite, the one who lost the bet would want to get those lands back, or in this case, his nephew would, right? Because it's young Fortinbras who ends up being angry about it and wanting to get the lands back. So it seems a little short-sighted, I guess. Although it is true that it puts fewer lives on the line at that moment, for sure. Any other comments on that?
I also think it's worth pointing out that rulers sometimes define through their rule what is natural and what is unnatural. You know, if we look at, so Elizabeth I is on the throne during the production of this play, but if we look at her father, Henry VIII, he essentially broke away from what was natural dealings in the Catholic Church and created a new religion in order to do things that he wanted to do. Mm-hmm. I think, you know, rulers throughout history, even if we look back at the Bible and we look at the books of the Bible like Kings and Samuel, which say that, you know, man was never meant to rule over man, only God was meant to rule over man. So when we come into this question of kings and divine right and who should rule, it's a question of who is doing God's bidding, who's listening to God. And that has always been up for interpretation based mm-hmm. on who was in charge and what they wanted to do. Mm-hmm. So I think, you know, old Hamlet is creating his own system of what he feels to be natural to you know, get the job done that he wants to get done. And Claudius is rewriting this idea of what's natural based on what he wants to accomplish.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Right, but in a different way of using the words, all of those human, all that human work, all that rational creation of institutions, of rational institutions, that's all unnatural because it's something other than the earth and the sky and the, you know, those that definition of nature. So again, like, I keep coming back to Howard's first comment about what is human nature really? And to me, this is at the heart of the play. I've sometimes asked my students, do you think Hamlet is a rational individual who has to work up the emotion to kill somebody, which is a very difficult thing to accomplish? Or do you think Hamlet is an emotional person whose reason is telling him, hey, you know what? Maybe not so much with the killing. Maybe figure out first whether your uncle really committed the murder, right? Like, which one of those is at the heart of who Hamlet is? And then it plays out in a lot of other characters and scenarios too. But is he fundamentally rational and has to work up the emotion? Or is he fundamentally emotional and has to work through a process of reasoning because something drives him to need to do that? Maybe it's religion, or maybe it's, you know, maybe it's something else. But that question of which one of those is human nature, is it to be rational, is it to be thinkers, or is it to be more rash, more impulsive, more emotional? That, to me, that drives a lot of the characterization in the play. And it drives a lot of the way some of the different characters use language. And also the something else that has been mentioned in previous discussion is the use of foil characters in this play is really, really prominent, right? Like you've got, like we were just talking about, you've got old Hamlet, young Hamlet, old Fortinbras, young Fortinbras. You've got Polonius and Laertes. So Hamlet has Laertes as a foil, where Hamlet is kind of slow to act and doesn't immediately want to rush in with his sword. Laertes hears that Polonius is dead and he comes storming back with his sword up, ready to go. So that use of foils throughout this play, foil characters, I think is setting up the idea of various ways of responding to the dilemma. And some of them are emotional and passionate, and some of them are reasoned and thoughtful. And some of them are one thing pretending to be another thing and using words and using language and using disguise and deceit as a cover for what it really is. So I just think that there's a lot happening there, which, you know, you guys are raising all those points. Other thoughts or other speeches that come to mind as being relevant here? I'm gonna click back to the thing here. Okay, so this is coming to this last point here. When Hamlet is preparing the players to play the mousetrap, the play within a play, he tells them to or step not the modesty of nature, but instead hold the mirror up to nature. He also says later that he wants the man who's not passion's slave, which if we're opposing nature and passion, those seem related. But I'm really interested in this phrase, hold the mirror up to nature, and I would love to get some reactions to that. I do think that, and again, I need my Elizabethan experts to come help me with this, but I think that a mirror at this time was a fairly recent piece of technology, right? To have a mirror that could actually reflect was definitely a rational invented device that was fairly recent in Elizabethan times. So the idea that we're holding a mirror up to nature is really a contrast between a human device and nature.
Well, mirrors were in use thousands of years before Elizabethan times. It may have been that they were becoming more common, and not just for the very, very, very wealthy and elite, but there are mirrors from Egypt and Babylon.
Mm-hmm. Were they at this time any better quality?
Those mirrors were made of bronze, so it might be that these are the first mirrors made of glass. The ones in ancient times were made of
polished bronze. Mirrors were made of silver. You can't make a mirror out of bronze. They're made
out
of silver.
Sorry, they were made out of polished metal and didn't reflect the way we think of a mirror now. So it might be that if they're talking about a glass mirror, it would be a different technology.
Yeah, I can't remember where I heard this point being made about mirrors in Elizabethan times, so I really don't have the facts at my fingertips, but I just think that it's a really interesting phrase, holding the mirror up to nature, in terms of Hamlet giving that advice to the players.
Well, my thought about holding it up to nature is insert the word human, hold the mirror up to human nature, and then that line makes a lot more sense.
That would mean so the players are supposed to play human emotions as they are.
I think that makes the most sense in terms of, particularly if you're going with natural versus unnatural. I'm not talking about maybe not necessarily not being passionate, but being passionate within the bounds of what you would see in the ordinary course of what you would see in the ordinary course of humanity, of life, and not overblown, which I think is another word that's in that speech, the word overblown, because he doesn't want these people to, you know, give these like overmighty like statements. And it's kind of interesting to point out with this speech is I've always kind of thought of it as Shakespeare writing both as Shakespeare the playwright and Shakespeare the director.
Sure. Yeah. And that's, you know, one of my fears in pursuing this line of thought is I think there is this little bit of this impulse to always see Shakespeare's plays as being about theater, which can be a little tiresome, I think, sometimes. But here, I really think that there's something to that, that he is genuinely talking about the nature of acting. And he, you know, I'm not sure about overblown. It might be. It's definitely, there's, in what I'm showing now, there is overdone, right? So he does seem to be saying, you know, tone it down a little. The best way to represent the reality of human emotion on stage is to keep it in check a little bit and to tone it down a little.
Well, this is a big test for him because when the players come on, they're going to see if, you know, if Claudius is the bad guy or not. And he doesn't want them to screw up. He doesn't want to ham the play in front of him. It has to come over very, very powerful, I would have thought.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he doesn't want them to screw it up for sure. What would their overplaying it, how would that screw it up? Would that make it easier for Claudius to ignore it, do you think? Or what's the logic there?
You could laugh it off. You could laugh it off.
Laugh it off, yeah. It would come off as funny. Yeah, so the more realistic, in the context of theater, in the context of a play, the more realistic way to represent emotion is to tone it down a little bit, because if it's too overblown, it comes off as fake and might even strike him as funny.
I also think he wants Claudius to see himself in the play. So, you know, he wants Claudius to recognize himself as the guy murdering Gonzago.
And Claudius himself...
I was going to say, if it's overdone, then he may not be able to relate to it.
Right, right. Because Claudius himself is kind of an understated guy, too. Not a wildly passionate guy. At least not yet. Okay. Right. So go back to this. It is like, I feel like we're a little more than halfway through. Do we feel the need for a break? Do you guys want to take a 5-minute break, get up and stretch your legs, or should we just keep going? Oops. Any votes for a break? There's somebody in the chat. Literature is the mirror. Yeah. Yeah. Literature is the mirror. So words, language, this is how we reflect upon ourselves. Is that the idea?
Haven't there been numerous studies done that have shown that people who are more prone to read fiction tend to have higher rates of empathy? See if you go in that direction with that quote.
Yeah, and that's actually another thing that I was kind of getting to here as well with this play within a play is another, yes, there are studies that show that. And there are also studies about mirror neurons that show that when you watch somebody else perform an action, when you watch somebody else perform an action, the same areas of your brain light up as they would if you yourself were doing that action. I think the particular experiment that's been done is with hammering a nail. If you watch somebody hammer a nail, the motor part of your brain that would be responsible for you hammering a nail will light up when you watch it. And I think that's at the heart, when Gerard was talking in the very first session about catharsis, I think that the if you want a scientific explanation for why catharsis happens in drama, it is that when you watch actions on stage, it is as if you are doing them to a certain degree, neurologically, right? Like you are experiencing those actions as if you're doing them. So that's certainly what Hamlet is hoping for when he plays the murder of Gonzago, right? He wants Claudius to feel that as if it's happening and to react in a way that gives him his necessary evidence. But it raises some really interesting questions. You know, there's a whole psychoanalytic way of reading Hamlet where you can talk about the play within a play and the mad scenes revealing what Hamlet himself is reluctant to reveal about himself and his own thinking, right? Because that's part of catharsis as well, is sort of bringing to the surface things that have been buried. The Greek root for catharsis is cleansing. So you're sort of ridding yourself and bringing out things that might otherwise stay hidden or stay tormenting you. So anything else before we go to the next phase of this? I'm gonna go back here. I think I may have enlarged this accidentally. No, okay. All right, so. I think I jumped ahead. Okay. So moving past the mousetrap to a couple of other instances, and you're probably getting tired of hearing the words, but a couple of other instances of these words. When Hamlet goes into his mother's closet, before he does that, he says his intention is for his heart to lose not its nature, and he wants to be cruel but not unnatural. I will speak daggers to her but use none. So given everything that's been said about natural and unnatural and irrationality and rationality and antic disposition and using language to convey your purpose or to hide your purpose. What are your thoughts on what Hamlet means in terms of his intentions when he goes to speak with his mother? What does it say about his character? And do you think that he succeeds in that scene in being cruel but not unnatural? And I can click over to the scene if we want to.
I think it's maybe just one big note to self, don't kill mom.
Yeah, I mean, the daggers thing is funny, you know, because he says he's not gonna, I will be cruel but not unnatural. I will speak daggers to her but use none. And then of course he immediately kills Polonius. And then later at the end of the scene, she says, oh Hamlet, your words have been like daggers to me. So he kind of can't escape this violent imagery. And you have probably seen various productions that have made this scene really, really violent. And I know that, again, Brendan was talking about his particular choice was to cut, he said, he was gonna cut some of the scene and not have it be quite so violent and misogynistic. And I'm scrolling to this part of it where he shows her the two pictures of the two brothers, because this strikes me as one of the crueler. It doesn't begin so terribly. I mean, it's not really nice, but it ends rather cruelly with, ha, have you eyes? You cannot call it love, for at your age, sense sure you have, but sure that sense is apoplexed. I mean, this is one of the harsher speeches in the play. So just going back to those questions really quickly, what does he mean by cruel but not unnatural, and does he succeed? Is the way he treats his mother there unnatural?
There's a sense in which the word rational can be replaced, nature can be replaced with the word rational.
Or is it the other way around? That's my question. Is it rationality that's actually being imposed on passion, and passion is the thing that's natural?
Mm-hmm. If we go that with the idea that of some kind of like natural order and a mother being a parental figure and honor thy father and thy mother from the Bible, maybe that's where he's going. I'll be cruel, but I won't be disrespectful.
Mm-hmm.
I won't dishonor her.
Did he succeed?
Well, I personally don't necessarily look at this instance of natural and unnatural in terms of reason or emotion. I tend to think of it more through the lens of like filial piety. So he might be speaking of being natural in terms of honoring both his mother, as you were talking about, but also his father. I kind of have always interpreted this scene as he's entering into it, trying to make his mother see how she has dishonored his father. So he's trying to be a good son in making her realize that she's been a bad wife. Mm-hmm. So in that sense, like, he may be referring to nature in terms of like the way that their family is naturally supposed to interact with one another. And that has broken and has fallen apart. And so he's trying to fix that, I guess. Although I don't necessarily think that's a very reasonable way to go about trying to fix a dysfunctional family situation. But.
Mm-hmm. Right. I mean, I think definitely you're right in this, the ghost comes back in this. I mean, in one sense, they're reunited as a little family unit, right? I mean, Gertrude doesn't see the ghost, but it is kind of interesting that the ghost returns in this scene. And he, his purpose, as I think you've talked about in some other, his purpose is to remind Hamlet after he really, in my mind, gets very carried away. I think he's not particularly rational or unnatural, if that's how that works. He's very natural. He's very emotional here. And he does reveal, you know, going back to that psychoanalytic reading, I think he does reveal some things that are really bugging him about Gertrude's behavior, and the aspect of Gertrude's behavior that really bugs him is not the possibility that she might have been complicit in the murder. It's really the sleeping with the uncle piece, right? Like, this speech really jumps out at me, and we've got that word rank again, where she's already said, "Oh, Hamlet, speak no more. You've accomplished your purpose. I'm looking into myself and I see these black and grained spots," but he keeps going, right? Like, "But to live in the rank sweat of an enseamed bed, stewed in corruption, honeying and making love over the nasty sty." These are really, there's not a lot of pretense here, right? There's not a lot of, I don't know. There doesn't seem to me to be very careful, thoughtful word choice. This is a very passionate, he's really caught up in the emotion of the moment. And it's at that point, and then again, he keeps going. And it's at that point that the ghost has to come back, that the ghost has to return. So I guess one of the questions I ask myself is with regard to Hamlet, what are the things that really get him worked up and emotional? And what are the things that don't as much? And to me, it seems that you know, his mother's corruption, his mother's sexual behavior gets him really worked up and angry, where the murder doesn't quite seem to have that same emotional effect.
He also gets vicious with Ophelia.
Yes.
And so again, this issue of sexuality or gender is also part of what really, really gets him going. He's almost as vicious. He's as vicious in those two scenes as he ever gets, it seems to me.
Yeah. It's that aspect of behavior, that sexual behavior, that's what breaks his rationality down.
I think it's deceit. It's deceit by Ophelia. And he blasts off at Rosencrantz and Guildenstern later on with the, you know, when he pulls out the recorder for them to play and says, you can play with this, but you mm-hmm. it's deceit. That's my picture.
Yeah, and I like that notion of deceit and being lied to. It is mm-hmm. When he really gets vicious in the scene with Ophelia when he realizes he's being watched, mm-hmm. that she mm-hmm. is in cahoots with the king and maybe and Polonius. He gets vicious at that point.
Mm-hmm. No, there's no question. I think that's absolutely true that deceit really makes Hamlet angry. But I do think that in his scenes with Gertrude and with Ophelia, it goes beyond that. It really goes beyond that. I think he's the language that he uses and the types of things he brings up. And again, like there's this thing of, you know, the truth emerging through quote unquote mad language and jokes. And when Hamlet is putting his antic disposition on and pretending to be mad and joking with Ophelia at the scene of the mousetrap, he inevitably goes to the sexual, right? Like referring to her genitalia with the word nothing and the fishmonger, which has a sexual gloss of accusing Polonius of being a pimp. He seems to unfailingly go there when he's acting mad or when he's making a joke or confronting his mother, confronting Ophelia with their deceit. It seems to verge into something else, I think. Any more thoughts about that?
There's two things Hamlet doesn't seem to do very well. Talk about sex and handle nuance.
I think that these questions about the scene in the mother's closet and rationality, irrationality, cruel, unnatural, etc., and why this happens now, right? Like the mousetrap has been interrupted. He kind of got his answer, but then Claudius went away, and he, you know, there's a sort of a, as you've talked about before in previous sessions, this question of like what happens now. Everything is a little bit in chaos. It raises a lot of questions about what's really driving Hamlet and what's driving, I think to a certain degree, and this is where it's going to kind of take a little bit of a turn, but what's driving male characters versus female characters in general, and what is supposed to drive them? What are the expectations of what is supposed to drive them? One of the things that I think about Hamlet, and this is, you know, where to a certain degree I am trying to make the play a little bit, you know, using a contemporary term to, I'm just trying to move this over so I can see what my own slide says. Using a contemporary term to bring it to students, there's a way in which, here's my next slide. There's a way in which I think that the very current term toxic masculinity applies to Hamlet. And the way I see that playing out is that there seems to be this expectation of men, an expectation of Hamlet in general, that it's good for them to be angry and it's good for them to be violent and warlike, right? Like that was the previous king. He was violent, he was warlike, and that was good. It's not so good for them to show grief, right? like we see grief referred to as being unmanly. So there's this very strong expectation that Hamlet will swoop in and commit a murder, that he will not show too much grief, and that that's just something he's going to be able to work himself up to do. And that seems really hard for Hamlet. And I've quoted this particular critic, A.C. Bradley. He's got a long essay in the Norton Critical Edition, which I don't like all of it, but I do like the way he describes this action that's required of Hamlet as very exceptional, right? It's very violent, it's dangerous, it's difficult to accomplish perfectly, it's repulsive to a man of honor and sensitive feeling, right? To commit a murder, even if it's a justified murder, that's a difficult thing. And then there's a certain mystery, and I think what he might be referring to there is the spiritual aspect of it, right? Like Hamlet is concerned about his soul, and he's concerned about heaven if he commits this sin of killing somebody. So there's a lot happening there where Hamlet is the expectation placed upon him is to do something that he's not really very inclined to do. So I feel like the idea of toxic masculinity, of expectations of men, fits with Hamlet there, which is to say that it's damaging to him, right? Like it's painful and difficult for him to have to meet those expectations. But to your point about talking about sex, there's another way in which he meets expectations perfectly, right? Like I think that another aspect of what was expected of men in this, or what seems to be expected of men in this play, is that they will kind of stand guard over and pay attention to and protect and defend women's sexuality, right? So that he's very willing to jump in and do and become very passionate about doing, which I think is what we see in this scene with his mother. And the ghost has to come back and be like, Hamlet, yeah, your mother slept with your uncle. That happened. But you know what? Leave her to heaven. She will be punished in heaven, and I'm coming here to remind you that it's the other aspect of the task, it's the other aspect of what you've been charged to do that you need to refocus on. And then, so I'll just go to the next one, just look at Ophelia. I think Ophelia falls victim to this kind of toxic masculinity as well, and I'm going back to this earlier speech about rot being inside flower buds. And I know you've talked before about her drowning and about her, why that happens and how that happens. I think there's something about her gathering flowers, flowers sort of representing, youth and virginity and, a young woman, right? There's something about her gathering flowers and then having to not having to, but dying at that same moment, drowning at that same moment that she was out there gathering flowers. I almost feel like part of what Laertes seems to be saying is it might be too late already, Ophelia. You might be that flower bud that's rotted on the inside already. There's this sense of women being corrupted already by their nature that seems to victimize Ophelia as well. I may have lost some of my logic here, but let me stop sharing. There's a particular performance. You've probably seen Helena Bonham Carter's portrayal of Ophelia, which is kind of relevant here. I don't love everything about that movie, but I do like her performance, and it generates a lot of interesting conversation. So let me stop sharing for a second and just see what you guys think about that idea that there's some relevance of the modern term toxic masculinity to Hamlet. Yeah, somebody's pointing out in the chat, somebody's pointing out that Hamlet says that his mother posts dexterously to incestuous sheets, which is, again, one of those very resonant, meaty lines to say. And his disgust, those hissing S's, I think are part of what convey his very visceral disgust with what his mother's done. He's not just angry at her deceit. Like I hear what Richard is saying, but I don't think he's just angry about her deceitfulness. I think he's really disgusted by her sexuality, by her sexual behavior. So I've talked, I just threw a bunch of stuff out there. Any thoughts or reactions to any of that?
I don't think that Hamlet's behavior is out of the norm for his time and Shakespeare's time. And I've always thought that his treatment of Ophelia, while horrid, stemmed from the fact that he was in love with her and he wanted her out of this and he wanted to try to get her to disengage. Mm. I don't think he anticipated that she would jump in the river and kill herself.
Mm-hmm. I think I agree with you 100% that his behavior is not out of the norm. I guess what I'm suggesting is that I think the play is questioning that norm. You know, I think the play, by throwing this whole pattern of what's rational, what's irrational, what's a human institution, what's a human expectation, and what's really built into our nature, I think the play is, one thing it's doing is maybe asking us through Hamlet to question that norm, that automatic sense of like, you have to act with violence, you have to react to violence with violence. So I agree with you totally that Hamlet's behavior fits the norms of his time, but I just think the play is asking us to question those norms.
I think you're giving him too much credit.
Interesting.
I think you're doing the typical thing of using our norms and mores and evaluating a previous era.
Well, I think Shakespeare and the play itself aren't necessarily the same thing. It can be difficult, I think, when we're looking at the text itself, but because it's a play and so often is in performance, you know, I think if you're doing a performance even of a text that's, you know, hundreds of years old, then you're using a modern context in some capacity just by virtue of it being, you know, put on now with current actors and, you know, everything.
Yeah.
So I think, you know, we can't necessarily pass everything on to be like, oh, and Shakespeare was definitely doing this. But the play and Shakespeare don't necessarily have to be the same thing.
I also think as a revenge drama, since mostly the setup in revenge drama is the religious conflict between and cultural conflict between, I should avenge the death of a relative, but I shouldn't because then I will be damned. And Hamlet is that plot, but he's chosen not to go in that direction. So I would also be really hesitant to say that Shakespeare was going so far as to like personally advocate for that, but he has set it up in a way that is sort of interpretable by that us now, if that makes sense.
There's a couple comments in the chat which I'll just read. His from Nancy, his obsession with his mother is a distraction for him. Yeah, I think that's true. I think it's certainly a distraction from what his expected purpose is, but again, the idea of the prevailing culture, there are other men in the play who are very concerned with governing female sexuality, right? So certainly at the moment when he's supposed to be committing a murder, yes, his obsession with his mother is a distraction, but it's a distraction that is in keeping with what seems to be the culture of the male culture of the play or of the time and the place. And then another comment, Shakespeare is no feminist. What is now toxic masculinity was then hubris. Huh, interesting. Hubris. Interesting. I'm not sure. Who's hubris? Hamlet's own hubris? Not quite sure how that would work. That commenter will have to say a bit more.
I would argue Shakespeare is very much a feminist. There are very few strong men, tons of strong women. And in terms of the male-female ratio, bear in mind that there's a problem for him because there were no women allowed on the stage. So all the women's part had to be played by boys, which, you know, the recruitment pool must be decreased. So that's against him. But I don't, he's a feminist. Shakespeare is a feminist.
Mm-hmm. There's a lively discussion happening in the chat about Taming of the Shrew. If Shakespeare is asking the audience to question how women are treated, then how do you explain Taming of the Shrew? It depends on the staging of Taming of the Shrew. Taming was a much earlier play in terms of when he wrote it. Yeah, those are all, all really interesting questions. I mean, the play that CSC just did too, Measure for Measure, raises some really interesting questions about powerful women and the limits of women's power and men's power through sexual control and all those kinds of things, which goes back to the idea of you know, Shakespeare's intention versus the text of the play raising questions that are interesting to explore, which goes all the way back to Gerard's beginning of this, which was Shakespeare then, now, and forever. Other thoughts about this? Other comments? Are people familiar with Helena Bonham Carter's Ophelia already? Is that something I should show? Is that something you'd like to watch? Yes, I see a thumbs up. Okay, I was originally planning to try to do a few more performance comparisons, but I learned fairly recently that video playing on Zoom is a little bit limited. There's a lot of things that you can't use. So I did have to cut back a little bit in terms of what I was able to show. But I do think that Helena Bonham Carter's performance of Ophelia is very interesting in terms of sexual double standard. So I will go ahead and share my screen, and I will share the computer sound, which is.
And I would say everybody turn off their videos, because that speeds up makes it easier to get over a video.
Oh, okay, great. Thank you for that tip. That's wonderful. Okay, so share, and I will click on this YouTube link.
You have to understand one thing about directing, that promise me to wed, so would I had done by yonder sun, and thou hadst not come to my bed.
Come, my lady.
To my sick soul, as sin's true nature is, each toy seems prologue to some great amiss. So full of artless jealousy is guilt, it spills itself in fearing to be spilt.
Where is the beauteous majesty of Denmark? Where is the... How now, Ophelia? He is dead and gone, lady.
dead and gone. At his head a grass green tuft, at his heels a stone.
How long has she been thus?
So I'm stopping it there. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. So I'm stopping it there. It does go on a little bit, but there's a couple things I think are really interesting about that. And I'll just give my own take and then would love to hear again from other people. The little song story that Ophelia tells about the maid in the chamber, and then quoth he before he tumbled me, promised me to wed, so what I had done by yonder sun had, and thou hadst not come to my bed, is really expressing this double standard of, right, like, we're gonna get married, so come sleep with me. Oh, you slept with me, you're a slut, I'm not gonna marry you now. Right, so it's very expressive of the double standard and the bind that she finds herself in. She's been placed there by the sort of guard, the male guardians of her sexuality, and I think that in Ophelia's madness, the truth of that comes out. Her true expression of that comes out, and I think that I think it's very interesting how Helena Bonham Carter plays that up to a great degree. I also think what's even more interesting maybe is the way that the male soldier and then Gertrude react to it, which is that they are frightened. The male soldier could easily laugh at what's happening. He could easily reciprocate with some sexual gesture of his own. And certainly maybe there's a power thing happening, right? Like she's nobility and he's afraid of the repercussions if he treats her disrespectfully or whatever. But I think his fear at that moment, his kind of fear of her sexuality is really interesting. And Gertrude being afraid of that expression is super interesting to me. So I would love other people's comments on that. And I will read also what's in the chat. My eyes are sort of failing me. I'm gonna have to put on my glasses for the chat this time. I think the women he wrote speak volumes to the contrary. I would highly recommend Women of Will by Tina Packer. It's an excellent look into how Shakespeare was absolutely a feminist for his time. And somebody responds, I would call that a creation of Tina Packer, not W.S., not William Shakespeare. Okay, good book recommendation to generate some conversation. Any reactions to that performance? Good, bad? I'm open to hearing everything.
Great.
Great, you like it, it's great. Is that what you said?
Yes.
I think it's interesting how between that and then, oh my goodness, why am I not remembering her name, from the Grandma Hamlet.
Kate Winslet.
How both of them kind of use sexuality in that, I mean, in very illicit, specific ways. Mm-hmm. And I think if we take Ophelia's mumblings and rantings for true pay, then, you know, you can maybe guess out what her relationship was in reality with Hamlet.
Mm-hmm. Emily, I like what you said about like Gertrude and the soldier being afraid, mm-hmm, of Ophelia's outbursts. Something that always interests me is, you know, the film is a little different, but in the actual play, what happens is someone comes up to Gertrude and says, Ophelia wants to speak with you, and she says, no, tell her she will not speak with me. Right. And there's a little back and forth where she refuses to talk to Ophelia, and there's like some fear or some anxiety about it. Yeah. And then eventually she's like, okay, we'll tell her to come in. And I'm always interested in that because I'm like, well, what is that? Like, what is she nervous about?
Right.
And I think this movie kind of dramatizes it very well. But I think there is, as you said, some fear and anxiety about Ophelia's sexuality and her mm-hmm. descent into madness.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think the way I see it, you know, going back to the question about the Kenneth Branagh Hamlet, which shows them actually in a very sexual scene before the actual events of the play, I don't, for my own reading of the play, I don't really buy that. You know, at the very beginning, I said I'm not a fan of Hamlet in some ways. And one of the things that, so going back to the idea of toxic masculinity, right? Like if I can really appreciate that Hamlet is very reluctant to be violent in the way that his society seems to push him to want to be violent, right? I can really appreciate that he wants to determine the guilt or innocence of Claudius. I can really appreciate that he wants to pause before committing murder, that he wants to delineate himself as a scholar and not as a warrior. I really like all those facets of Hamlet, and I like the suggestion of, you know, maybe Danish society is a little bit too rash and a little bit too angry and a little bit too impulsive. Naturally, I like all that. I think Hamlet's a bit of a prude though. And his kind of, his willingness to sort of question the prevailing moray of violence falls apart a little bit, where he is so he so easily falls in line with the other prevailing moray, which is to judge and condemn and want to control the sexuality of the women. Around, you know, the women in his life, the women in the play. Part of me wants to shake him a little bit and say, you know what, Hamlet, women have sex, even your mother. You don't have to talk about it. You don't have to like it, but it happened, you know. there's something prudish about Hamlet. And that's why I don't really buy the sexual relationship with Ophelia. I just think Hamlet is a little bit too cold in his nature, like a little bit too much of a prude to have gone there. You know, obviously, as with everything, so much room for interpretation. I think the letter that he writes, right, the letter that Polonius reads, where he's written her a poem, there's nothing sexual about his poem, right? Like, it's almost laughably kind of childish. I don't really buy that, but again, you know, like obviously other people are gonna make other arguments. There's a chat. I have to put my glasses on again. Maybe Hamlet's gay. Yeah, I don't know. Maybe are you suggesting that because of his sort of almost excessive disgust for women's sexuality? Is that part of what's going into that comment? Maybe, I'm not sure.
He's pretty close to Horatio.
Yeah, and actually that raises another interesting thing about the CSC production and the playing with gender in the casting. Horatio as a woman is, I think could be super interesting, but going back to, let me turn these off for one second. Going back to Laertes' speech to his sister and the contagious blastments, hang on. All these windows here. Going back to Laertes' speech to his sister and the contagious blastments and the concern that her bud might be rotten before it even opens. It's hard for me to see a woman, a sister, giving that speech to another sister. I'm not quite sure how that's going to work. And I know, Brendan was obviously so, so thoughtful in his presentation. I'm sure they're thinking through it. But I don't quite see how that's going to work myself. So let's see. Hamlet, here's another chat. Maybe Hamlet's gay and his queer-coded relationship with Horatio. Hamlet has lost his father and is in a state as a result, not normally this volatile. Yeah, for sure. It's just that I think that it's his mother that drives him, that really puts him in a state more than the loss of his father. I guess that's my prevailing argument, is that it's really the behavior of his mother that puts him in that wild, passionate, emotional mode, and not so much the anger at his father, which is what he's kind of supposed to be angry about. Okay. So very last comment. We have about 5 minutes left. Couple of final comments. I know you've already talked about the way that Ophelia dies and Gertrude's description of the drowning. I keep hearing noise and I'm realizing it's me. Okay, there we go. Got rid of it. So there was some conversation in an earlier class about why doesn't Gertrude help Ophelia, which is a really interesting question. And that fear piece that that Gerard was talking about and that you could see in the movie clip kind of I think takes some of that on. But I also think that part of why that speech is there is a little bit as a set piece, and that we're not necessarily meant to read it as Gertrude offering reportage, but more Gertrude speaking, you know, some thoughts about what's happened to Ophelia more broadly than that, if that makes sense. And there, in that speech, not only is Ophelia gathering flowers, she's particularly gathering one flower, the long purple, which it's pointed out has another sexual name to it. And then also her skirts, her feminine dress is what gathers the water and pulls her down in the end. So there is a way, and again, this goes back to the conversation about what did Shakespeare intend and what are we putting there or reading into it. But there is this idea of, you know, her feminine dress, her femininity is what kind of pulls her down and causes her to have to drown. I also think that Laertes' speech where he talks about her the bud already being rotten on the inside, I kind of feel like it's a little bit hopeless for Ophelia from the very beginning, that she was sort of ruined from the beginning. Like she didn't really have a chance. Like once Laertes says that to her, it's sort of like, well, you know, you what are you going to do? You're rotten before you even start. And maybe that's what's fearful to Gertrude or fearful to other characters in the play. So I don't know. It is 7:57. So I did have one last thing. I would love, again, for more comments. And I did have one last thing, which I sometimes use with students, and I'll just throw out there. You can look it up on your own if you like. It's kind of a lighthearted ending, which is that The Simpsons has a version of Hamlet. That's about 5 minutes long. And it's the Simpsons characters playing out Hamlet. And at one point in my teaching career, I haven't done this recently, but at one point in my teaching career, we actually gave this as a final exam on Hamlet. We showed them showed the students the Simpsons Hamlet, and their test was to explain 5 of the jokes. So if you all as students in this class want a kind of a fun final assessment, that's one that I'll just put on the table. You can watch The Simpsons Hamlet and pat yourself on the back for understanding the jokes. Okay, last thoughts. There's another comment about not gay, but a mama's boy. His mother is the only woman for him. He treats Ophelia with disdain. Yeah, that piece about him kind of being jealous of Claudius, that Oedipal piece, is another part where that's a place where I don't, and again, you know, to be casual about it, I don't totally buy that. I think he's just mostly a prude. The same production we were just watching, the Mel Gibson version, has the scene with his mother extremely sexualized. He's simulating sex with his mother. And I've never, that doesn't work for me. I've never really thought that made a lot of sense. I think he's mostly disgusted by sex. Whether it's Ophelia or his mom or anyone else, I'm not sure about that part. Other comments, other thoughts?
Thank you very much.
Well, thank you for having me. It was a pleasure. I enjoyed putting it together and I enjoyed being here. Thank you.
I have a question about natural and unnatural. Back to the beginning, do you think that perhaps Shakespeare is saying that murder is an unnatural act and wrong, but revenge murder is natural, rational and justified? And that kind of a split personality delivered to an audience was much more receptive because Shakespeare certainly wasn't depending on selling a lot of books, but he wanted to sell a lot of tickets. So maybe he presented that natural, unnatural concept that pleased everybody in some way and sold a lot of tickets. And the word got around that there's a play for everyone.
Right. If you're given to violence, if violence is your natural tendency, hey, there's a certain kind of violence that's fine. But if you're more of a scholar type and you have questions about violence, well, hey, so what does this mean? Yeah, no, there's something to that. And that goes back to that question of, you know, each character using nature in the way that suits it's really mostly men, but each character using the word nature in the way that suits his personality, right? Any other final comments? We've been here for a couple hours, so I do not blame you if you would like to just duck out. But thank you very much for having me. This was a pleasure. And I also really enjoyed all your comments in the previous classes. So I wasn't enrolled, but I did listen to them. And I thought you were very, very thoughtful in previous sessions as well as today. So thank you did you want to close with anything?
No, just to say thank you. Thank you, Emily, for closing us out strong, and thanks to everyone else for being a part of the class. This was a lot of fun, and we all are super glad we were able to do it. So have a great, what is today, the 4th? Have a great May 4th. And I will be seeing you all soon. A couple of people have asked me about classes in the future, and we are thinking about what we can offer, what we may offer, and how that will manifest itself. So just keep following us, and there will be information coming out in the future. But in the meantime, have a great week. And see you all around. Thanks so much.
Thanks, everybody.
Thanks, Gerard. Thanks, everyone.
Thanks, Gerard.
Thank you.
Great class.
Thank you. Thank you, CSC. Bye.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone.